Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel. I'm a general physician. I'm not an endocrinologist. Today we'll be discussing on one of the very useful topic, very commonly you see in your everyday practice, and the most common endocrine disorder seen in your everyday practice. That is hypothyroidism, or we call mixed edema when it occurs in adults, and in neonates, we call cretinism. So, hypothyroidism is the most common disorder among all endocrine disorders, which you see in your everyday practice, and it is very common in female. We call mixed edema, or we call cretinism, depending upon the age. We'll be discussing under all those common heading, definition, etiology, pathophysiology, clinical features, investigation, differential diagnosis, treatment, and complications. So by definition, hypothyroidism is a disorder in which thyroid gland fails to secrete adequate amount of thyroid hormone. When thyroid gland fails to secrete the thyroid hormone in an adequate quantity, we call that as a primary hypothyroidism. And when pituitary or hypothalamus results into decreased function of thyroid gland, we call that as a central, or we call that as a secondary hypothyroidism. If it is because of pituitary, we call pituitary induced hypothyroidism, hypothalamic induced hypothyroidism. But now common terminology utilized is central hypothyroidism, or we call secondary hypothyroidism. While mixed edema is a form of hypothyroidism where you get a group of symptoms and signs which are in favor of hypothyroidism, plus supraclavicular puffiness, malar flush, yellowish tint to the skin, etc. Plus, when the person goes into altered level of consciousness, severe mental retardation, hypothermia, etc., we call that as mixed edema coma, where the rate, metabolic rate drops so low that it may be life-threatening. Temperature is very low. Blood pressure, there will be fall of blood pressure. Person will develop hypoglycemia, and mental function deterioration will take place. That we group them into one group, we call as a mixed edema coma. While cretinism is also called as a congenital hypothyroidism, which is because of thyroid degenesis in newborn, or mother who is on antithyroid drugs, or mother develops dietary deficiency, particularly severe iodine deficiency, and the newborn children will have a hypotonia, prolonged jaundice, enlarged tongue, may have umbilical hernia, coarse and thick skin, hoarse cry, and they require levothyroxine once a day in the morning orally. This is a typical phase of a cretinism. This is during early age. This is little during late age. You can see mentally retarded, stunted growth, etc. Some of the terminology we utilize in a hypothyroidism is congenital and acquired. This is on an etiology. And that can be primary, or we call secondary, or we always use the word central. Primary or central, or we call secondary. So central or secondary can be congenital or acquired. Site-wise, it can be primary, secondary, or tertiary. Now this secondary and tertiary word are usually replaced by central. Secondary is pituitary induced, tertiary is hypothalamic induced. Some of the time, the disorder is for a very short period, that is we call transient. Say, as for example, in a postpartum period, transient period, or it may remain permanent. So it persists for a long period, we call it a permanent. Then depending upon the symptom signs and thyroid hormone level, it is divided into subclinical variety and clinical variety, or we call as subclinical and overt variety. Grading of the goiter, enlargement of the thyroid gland is called goiter. And if there is a localized enlargement of a thyroid gland and there is a glandular appearance, we call as a adenoma. And if there is a malignant conversion of that, we call it as adenocarcinoma. But if there is an enlargement of a small part of a thyroid gland and all surrounding tissue is normal, then we call that as a nodule. Usually nodule, we say that when it is more than 1 centimeter in size, we call that as a nodule. As far as the different stages is concerned, in the early age, or we call newborn, we call cretinism or congenital hypothyroidism. In adult, we call myxedema. And when you get a severe deficiency of hypothyroid hormone, a person goes into a stage we call as a myxedema coma. So these are all the different terms which are being utilized in a hypothyroidism. So primary, we already told you the most common cause of hypothyroidism is primary. It accounts for almost 90% of the cases in which there is decreased level of T34 and increased level of TSH. Because of primary defect in a thyroid gland, there is a decreased production of T34, which results into elevated level of TSH by pituitary gland. In a subclinical hypothyroidism, T4 level is normal. Usually we label that as a free T4 level is normal, but there is a slight elevation of TSH level. And this is called mild hypothyroidism, early thyroid failure, or preclinical hypothyroidism, or decreased thyroid reserve. Now the term utilizes subclinical hypothyroidism, and they are usually asymptomatic. While central variety or a secondary variety of hypothyroidism, it is a condition where low T4 serum concentration and TSH level is also low in comparison to T4 level. Usually when the T4 level is low, there is no negative feedback mechanism, so TSH level will start rising. But here the TSH level will be low, T4 and T3 level will be also low, and that we call as a central variety. In a person with a pituitary, there is no production of a TSH, or there is a decreased production of TSH. So there is low level of TSH, which will result into low formation of T34 from thyroid gland. Then we call it a pituitary induced hypothyroidism. And if TRH production by hypothalamus is reduced because of damage to the hypothalamic gland, then T4 level will be low, TSH level will be low. Also, TRH level is low. So if TRH, TSH and T4, all the three levels are low, then usually it is labeled as a tertiary, or we call it as a hypothalamic induced hypothyroidism. But now the common term utilized is a central hypothyroidism, or we call secondary hypothyroidism. If it persists for a very short period, we call it a transient variety or temporary hypothyroidism. And it is very commonly seen in subacute thyroiditis as one of the phases where you get for a temporary period hyperthyroidism. There is one another term which is being utilized is consumptive hypothyroidism, which is increasing number of clinical setting, is a result of accelerated inactivation of thyroid hormone by type 3 thyronine deiodinase, or we call it a D3. So when D3 hormone, that is deiodinase 3, type 3, iodothyronine deiodinase, that is D3, accelerates the activity that will convert T3 into reverse T3, which is inactive form, and then that we call as a consumptive hypothyroidism. Rare conditions. A very simple way to classify is congenital and acquired, primary and secondary, clinical and subclinical, or we call overt and mild variety, persistent and transient. These are some of the words which are very commonly utilized, and while making a diagnosis, you will have to use etiology-wise congenital, acquired, primary and secondary, clinical symptoms-wise clinical or subclinical, or we call overt and mild variety, and duration-wise permanent and transient. So try to identify this particular on a clinical ground and by laboratory parameters. As far as the site is concerned, we already mentioned primary is basically thyroid gland disorders. Secondary means pituitary gland disorders. And tertiary means hypothalamic induced disorders. Now, pituitary and hypothalamic are called central. If it is right from birth, usually it is congenital. And if it is acquired, say like because of surgery, radiation, traumatic injury, vascular, etc., we'll call that as acquired variety. Yes, symptom-wise, subclinical and clinical. Clinical is also called overt, and subclinical is also called as a mild variety. Overt variety is also sometimes utilized. That word is not commonly utilized. Frank myxedema or frank hypothyroidism. So according to the age, at the birth, congenital, as a child grows, we use cretinism. Sometimes the word utilized is juvenile hypothyroidism, adult hypothyroidism or adolescent hypothyroidism. And depending upon the severity wise, subclinical and clinical variety. Subclinical is also called mild, and clinical variety is called clinical or overt or frank hypothyroidism. Goiter, one way of classifying was grade 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 0, not visible, not palpable. Grade 1, not visible but palpable. Grade 2, visible and palpable. And you start getting symptoms of compressive symptoms. While grade 3, visible in all positions. Means laterally, anteriorly, you can very easily identify the enlargement of thyroid gland. You don't require to do even a palpation for identifying a thyroid gland. And when there is a very massive enlargement, we call it a large goiter, and usually this starts producing compressive symptoms. So in a grade 3 and 4, there is a compressive symptom. This is replaced by WHO grading, which divides only into 3, 0, 1 and 2. 0 is same. Not visible, not palpable. Grade 1, not visible but palpable. And grade 2, it is visible as well as palpable. Then we call that as a grade 2. It is not further divided into. All these three will be together and that will be grade 2. That is WHO classification. Etiology-wise, hypothyroidism you can divide into primary and secondary. We already tell you secondary is because of pituitary tumor, or because of hypothalamic disorders. Or destruction of a pituitary gland by surgery, radiation. Or because of Sehan syndrome. Post-pituitary, postpartum hypoplexy. Or maybe because of infiltration by lymphocytic hypophysitis. Usually pituitary tumors which will produce pituitary gland destruction can be alpha cell tumor, can be beta cell tumor, or can be chromophobe tumors. Or also tumors of hypothalamus. And one of the tumors of hypothalamus is craniopharyngioma, which can extend down and destroy the pituitary gland. And in this particular variety, you will always get involvement of corpus, we call optic chiasma. cavernous sinus, and it can produce compressive neuropathies involving 3rd, 4th, 5th and 6th cranial nerves. Also, it will produce raised intracranial pressure. It can also produce, if it extend down, damages the selector cecum, CSF rhinorrhea, or if it extends up, destroys hypothalamus, then you will have hypothalamic hormone production will be reduced, and it will produce also panhypopituitarism. And also destruction of pituitary gland can produce empty selector cecum and destruction of a clinoid process, widening of clinoid process, and finding of secondary findings on a skull because of raised intracranial pressure. This can be all the symptom signs in a secondary hypoparathyroidism. So do keep it in mind. This is Sehan syndrome, and also you can have a Simon's disease. While primary is usually because of enlarged thyroid gland, here the person will invariably have goiter, one of the two most common causes, Hashimoto's and iodine deficiency. And iodine deficiency is very common in certain areas like the area close to the Himachal Pradesh, Himalayan territories. So those areas are very severely iron deficiency. Once in a while, it can be because of lithium induced or because of genetic disorders like dysharmonogenesis. In all these conditions, you will have an enlarged thyroid gland, or we call goiter, very common. While normal thyroid gland can become hypothyroid because of spontaneous atrophy, or it can be because of destruction of the thyroid gland post-ablative, particularly surgery, radiotherapy, or because of subacute thyroiditis, suppurative thyroiditis, previous thyroidectomy, radioablation, medication exposures, and this can be permanent or transient, or can be subclinical variety. And here, slowly the size of the thyroid gland will be very small and it will be atrophic. There are some congenital conditions, particularly dysharmonogenesis, can result into primary hypothyroidism. By and large, in a post-ablative therapy, you can come across in early stage subclinical variety, and then later on it can become a overt, or we call it a manifest variety or a frank variety. So primary can be hormone dysgenesis, destruction of the thyroid gland because of surgery, radiation, etc. Autoimmune, where you get atrophy and goitrous formation, radiation, subtotal or total thyroidectomy, it can end up with hypothyroidism. It can be also secondary due to infiltration by amyloidosis, sarcoidosis, lymphomas, hemochromatosis, scleroderma, etc. This will also destroy the thyroid gland tissue, normal tissue. Already we have told you that it will be because of dysharmonogenesis, so hormone defects, congenital defect in hormone biosynthesis, because of iodine deficiency, very common in, we have already told you that is in Himalayan territories, they are severely iodine deficient. Because of some drugs, particularly lithium or iodine and iodine containing drugs, which can block the release of T3, T4 by what we call as a Chekhov's effects, Wolff-Chekhov effects. A person who is repeatedly subjected to radio contrast agents for radiography, that can also end up with hypothyroidism. Central variety is very commonly because of invasive lesion like microadenoma, craniopharyngioma, meningioma, gliomas, metastasis, secondary metastasis, carotid aneurysms, which can compress the pituitary gland, and can end up with a hypopituitarism. Or it can be following a cranial surgery, irradiation, or because of drugs, and that we can call as a secondary group, or we label also as iatrogenic groups, following a traumatic injury or head injuries, because of infarction, like Sehan syndrome, particularly in a postpartum, we call apoplexy, postpartum necrosis, or pituitary apoplexy. Certain immunological disorders where you get a lymphocytic infiltrations. Infiltrative disease, we already mentioned, hemochromatosis, sarcoidosis, infectious disease like tuberculosis, syphilis, mycosis, inherited, where the mutation takes place in the what we call as receptors, so you get peripheral resistance. Idiopathic variety, like we call unknown etiology, you come across what we call as empty cellar syndromes. There's a big list. These are all primary. Acquired variety, congenital variety, transient variety, usually in a post-thyroiditis, autoimmune thyroiditis, particularly in a postpartum thyroiditis. Consumptive, we already mentioned regarding consumptive hypothyroidism, where T4 is very rapidly converted into T3 is very rapidly converted by D3 enzyme, that is we call as a type 3 deiodine enzyme, into reverse T3, which is inactive form. So that particular can take place because of a drug induced, like tyrosine kinase inhibitor, Kuluche. Central variety can be acquired variety or a congenital variety, where central hypothyroidism can be pituitary induced or hypothalamic induced. Now that secondary and tertiary word is not utilized. In a congenital variety, it can be because of the structural deficiency or enzyme deficiency, or you can come across a resistance to thyroid hormone because of the abnormality in a thyroid receptors. One of the most common is Hashimoto's thyroiditis, and second most common is iodine deficiency. Other common disorders very commonly is because of thyroidectomy, radiotherapy, and because of anti-thyroid drugs. So this becomes iatrogenic. These are iatrogenic. This is genetic. Thyroid hormone dysgenesis or thyroid dysgenesis, dysharmonogenesis. In Hashimoto's, it can be transient or it can be permanent. Ratio-wise, female to male, not 8:1, it is almost 10:1. 90% of the cases are because of primary hypothyroidism. Risk factors, very common in male, age more than 60, in woman more than 35. It is more common in female as compared to males. Invariably in, we call as hypothyroidism because of Hashimoto's and iodine deficiency, they present with the goiter. Patient, there may be a strong history in a family of hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism. The person may also give you a history of thyroiditis. There will be a strong family history. Good number of times the person might have a head malignancy or a neck malignancy, or person has undergone a thyroid surgery, or person has been given radiotherapy. Good number of times there is an autoimmune disease like type 1 diabetes mellitus, or person may be on a drugs like lithium, amiodarone, steroids, interferon, etc. And good number of times the person will have a hyperlipidemia, where cholesterol level is markedly elevated, and you can have even xenthalasma. Same. Or person may be consuming some of the goitrogens. The most common goitrogens you come across, sulfonamides, lithium, para-aminosalicylic acid, oral hypoglycemic agents, certain cough medicines, some of the anti-thyroid drugs, which can end up with goiters. Among food, soya bean, cassava. This is very common. These are cassava roots. Cabbage can be goitrogen foods. This already we have discussed in a previous lecture, that is what we call as a thyroid introduction. That if it is a thyroid hormone, this will be in a normal person, Hypothalamus releases TRH, which will stimulate pituitary to release TSH. That will stimulate thyroid gland to release T34, and you will have a short loop and long loop negative feedback. In a person with a pituitary disorders, TRH is released, but pituitary cannot release TSH. And this will produce thyroid hormone. This is autoimmune thyroiditis. So in autoimmune thyroiditis, you have got a thyroid stimulating antibodies formation, which will give rise to antibody which will stimulate the thyroid gland, because these are stimulating antibodies, or there can be inhibitory antibodies. Stimulating will increase the production of a T3D4, which will have a negative inhibition to the pituitary gland, as well as it can have a negative inhibition to TRH also. So TSH formation and TRH formation will reduce. So this will be very common in autoimmune thyroiditis, where thyroid stimulating antibodies are formed. But in a person with a thyroid inhibitory antibodies, it will decrease the production of, we call T3D4, and it will end up with increased production of TRH and increased production of TSH. While pituitary induced TSH secretions, in a person with a pituitary damage, the TSH production is low. So TSH level is low. So thyroid gland cannot function. So you will develop secondary hypopituitarism, in which T3T4 level will be also low and TSH level will be low. In a hypothalamic induced, TRH production is low, TSH production will be low, and T3T4 production will be low. So this will be that particular effect. So decreased level of thyroid hormone, basal metabolic rate will be reduced, decreased GI motility. On heart, there will be decreased sympathetic activity, so bradycardia. On GI tract, decreased production of hydrochloric acid, so achlorhydria. Decreased basal metabolism, so will decrease heat production, so person will have a decreased basal body temperature. Increased lipid level, particularly cholesterol and triglycerides. Person will have a accelerated atherosclerosis, coronary artery disease, because of decreased production of RBC, anemia, B12 and folic acid deficiency. This will be all the typical picture what you will get in a case of a hypothyroidism, whether it is a primary or whether it is secondary. So you will have on a CNS, altered mental function because of decreased thermogenesis, hypothermia, decreased respiration, so hypercapnia and hypoxia, respiratory insufficiency, cerebral hypoxia, and person may go into a coma stage. Because of cardiovascular effect, inotropism and chronotropism is reduced, decreased cardiac output, vasoconstriction, low blood volume, decreased blood pressure, shock stage is a part of what we call as myxedema coma. As far as the fluid balance is concerned, increased vascular permeability, water retention, that fluid will come out. You will have an effusion. Because of dilution, you will have a hyponatremia. That will also add to your coma. We can call that as a hyponatremic, hypervolumic coma. In a child with hypothyroidism, we call it as a congenital hypothyroidism, macroglossia, prolonged jaundice, or we call prolonged hyperbilirubinemia, poor feeding, hoarse cry, decreased activity, mental retardation, constipation, umbilical hernia, dry yellow skin, large fontanelles, delayed skeletal maturation, even teeth formation is delayed, development is delayed, stunted growths, all these are part and partial features of a congenital hypothyroidism. So these are some of the symptoms in a congenital hypothyroidism. These are some of the symptoms in acquired hypothyroidism. I'm keeping this slide. You can go through your at leisure time in detail. It is mentioned in detail. So this is clinical features in infant. This is in children and young adolescents. in a young adolescent's growth failure, delayed bone maturation, delayed eruption of the permanent teeth, pseudodystrophy, delayed or precocious puberty, pituitary enlargement, galactorrhea, etc. Very, very common. And diagnostic algorithm-wise, if you want to detect in a newborn child, do T4 and TSH level. We call free T4 and TSH level. Initial TSH level will be high, and then the person will start having TSH level falling back. If you measure the TSH and free T4 level, usually you will come across two groups. One, where TSH level is high. So, along with that, the free T4 level is low. It confirms the diagnosis of primary, what we call as a congenital hypothyroidism. And this will be very commonly seen if the mother is already suffering from hypothyroidism and she is not well controlled. And other diagnosis, you will have to do radionucleotide uptake studies and scan, ultrasound to find out the size of the thyroid gland tissue and whether there is an uptake of a radioactive iodine or not. You can do the study of thyroglobulins, and you can do the maternal antithyroid antibodies study and urinary iodine level, because in this particular group of people, very frequently iodine deficiency results into these groups. While there will be another group where it can be because of secondary hypothyroidism, where TSH level will be low, T4 level will be also low, and this particular group of people will show you defect in pituitary gland or hypothalamus. We call that as a central hypothyroidism, where you can get a genetic defect, where TSB gene analysis defect will be there. You can have a pituitary hormone deficiency, other pituitary hormone will be also deficient. You can go for an MRI scan, look at the pituitary gland. You can look at the optic nerve for eye examination, because you will have a compression of optic chiasma producing compressive pathophysiology on an optic chiasma. This will be the investigation in a congenital hypothyroidism. This is a typical feature of a cretinism. As the child grows, mentally retarded, height will be less. Good number of time he can have a paraplegia. That limb will be having rigidity. Child may be deaf and mute. Facial typical expression. Brain development is poor. Musculoskeletal development is defective. Duration of deficiency will depend upon the severity. This will be all the features in a cretinism. Mentally retarded, growth deficient, paraplegia, rigidity, deaf mutism, distribution, facial distribution is very peculiar, and even brain development, skeletomuscular development, all are poor, and that will depend upon the severity and duration of the deficiency of thyroid hormone. You can divide hypothyroidism between two groups. We call it a primary variety and secondary variety. Almost the clinical features are nearly same, except you can differentiate by doing a TSH level. In a primary, TSH level will be high, while in secondary, TSH level will be low. Plasma cortisol level will be also affected in case of a secondary, because there is a damage to pituitary gland or there is a damage to hypothalamus. So cortisol level will be also low, while in a case of a primary, cortisol level is not affected. This is a peculiar, and you can detect the thyroid antibodies in case of primary, because the most common cause of primary is Hashimoto's thyroiditis and other groups of autoimmune thyroiditis. While in case of secondary, usually it is because of pituitary or hypothalamus, hence thyroid autoantibodies will be absent. So by these three common features, you can easily differentiate between primary and secondary. Otherwise, in both the condition, clinical presentation is nearly same. Except in secondary, you can have a pain hypopituitarism. multiple endocrine hormones produced by pituitary gland will be defective, will be hypo. Usually goiter is very commonly present in primary variety, while in secondary goiter is rarely seen in case of a secondary variety. And soft tissue edema is usually very severe in case of primary variety, while in secondary variety, usually it is not common feature. We sometimes say even it is absent. If you go through the common symptoms and signs, you can see that weakness, dry skin, coarse skin, lethargy, slow speech, or we call hoarse speech, eyelid edema, feeling cold, body temperature is low, decreased sweating, cold skin, most common features. As far as if you see, some of these features are not common. These are not very common. The percentage goes on reducing. So macroglossia, facial edema, coarse hair, loss of eyelids, hairs, what we call eyebrows, etc., mental retardation, memory loss, constipation, these are less. Weight gains, hair loss, etc. But the most common is this particular features. Most common. You can go through all. So these are some of the common features: depression, hair loss, unexplained weight gain, tiredness, dry skin, bradycardia, we call mixed edema, menstrual irregularity, infertility, difficulty in concentration, very, very common. These are typically described what we call as because of decreased metabolism, sensitivity to the cold, decreased appetite, decreased erythropoiesis, so anemia, even person can have a leukopenia, and even person can have a thrombocytopenia also. Because of decreased vitamin A, decreased sebaceous and sweat, sweating will be reduced, dry scaly skin, you will have a collection of a fluid, so we call mixed edema, you will have a hoarse voice, puffed up face, sodium retention will take place, and that will produce mixed edema. You will have a mucin deposition, albumin deposition, sodium deposition, so that will produce mixed edema, effusions. You can have a pericardial effusion, you can have a pleural effusion also, hoarse voice, puffed out face. Because of poor development of the brain, mental retardation, because of decreased neuromuscular excitability, sensory disturbances, hyporeflexia, depression, little altered level of consciousness, person may be little drowsy, clouded consciousness, decreased renal flow, decreased GFR. So salt and water retention is common. Also, there is a hyperlipidemia, cholesterol and VLDL level, even triglyceride level is increased, so it will accelerate atherosclerosis, and because of that you will have a very high chance of coronary artery disease. Because of decreased sympathetic activity on heart, decreased cardiac output because of bradycardia, and decreased inotropic effect, that is decreased contractility, you will have a reduced lipolysis, so weight gain will be there, fat deposition. In liver, decreased protein synthesis, elimination of the drug will be also reduced, so side effects of drugs will increase. The protein content in the body will reduce, so muscle mass will reduce. So because of that, fatigue, weakness, decreased gluconeogenesis and glycogenolysis, so that will produce hypoglycemia. That will also reduce your energy production, decrease BMR, and also person will have symptom signs because of the decreased energy production and heat productions. Intestinal motility will be reduced. Hello. Ah, Jai Sabnara. Pachi phone karsho, matyare lecture tayyar karusho amna. હા વાંધો નહીં વાંધો નહીં વાંધો નહીં, પણ અત્યારે આ લેક્ચર એક ચાલુ છે એટલે. હા ઓકે ઓકે ચાલો. હા મળે. સો બીકોઝ ઓફ ડિક્રીઝ ઇન્ટેસ્ટિનલ મોટિલિટી, કોન્સ્ટિપેશન, રિફ્લક્સ ઇસોફેજાઇટિસ ઓન બોન, રિટાર્ડેડ લેન્થ ઓફ ધ બોન્સ, ડિલેડ એપિફિસિયલ ફ્યુઝન્સ, સોમેટોટ્રોપિન રિલીઝ ઇઝ રિડ્યુસ. So usually the person will have a small stretches, very common in cretinisms. So these are all the features you can see. You will have a nail changes, skin changes. These are all the features which you can see: constipation, facial myxedema, lateral third of the eyebrow is lost, cold dry skin, decreased sweating, thick coarse hairs, cold intolerance, Raynaud's phenomena, sometimes you can see also, weight gain, depression, tiredness, weakness, fatigue, lot of symptoms and signs. You can see goiter, and particularly if severe iodine deficiency, person can have a big goiter and can produce a compressive symptoms, producing coughing, hoarseness of voice, difficulty in swallowing, difficulty in breathing because of compression of trachea, difficulty in swallowing because of esophagus, hoarseness of voice because of hypothyroidism itself and also because of recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy. Person will feel tightness in the neck, etc. So these are all the symptoms and signs. I can skip over. You can go through your leisure time. There are a lot of symptoms and signs. These are put together. Organ-wise, thyroid, liver, intestine, reproductive system, brain, heart, kidney, etc. Symptom system wise you can go through. These are again same way, general symptoms and signs: cardiovascular, blood, neuromuscular, gastrointestinal, skin, all we have already mentioned before. You can go through your leisure time. This is delayed tendon reflex, particularly very nicely elicitable in bicep, also in case of knee jerk very clearly, reproductive system, liver, etc. These are skin manifestation. Good number of time, hypothyroidism is associated with autoimmune disorders like type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes, infertility, hyperlipidemia leading to atherosclerosis, ischemic heart disease, cerebrovascular disease, depression. All those features are very frequently associated with. And good number of time, person will have a hyperlipidemia. Blood pressure will be low because of decreased blood volume. Risk of cerebrovascular disease because of increased lipids, endothelial dysfunction, and can end up with what we call as an ischemic heart disease, obesity, etc. All this can also be seen even in a subclinical hypothyroidism. So do keep it in mind. Subclinical hypothyroidism clinically may not have symptom signs of thyroid disorders, but may have associated hyperlipidemia, fall of blood pressure, hemostatic balance may be disturbed, advanced atherosclerosis, cerebrovascular disease, endothelial dysfunction, ischemic heart disease, and can be also associated with obesity. So do keep it in mind. You can have some of the other group of disorders like depressions. These are all those particular groups. These are all the different groups. These are together because of hypothyroidism. This is because of depressions, etc. This is if the person is untreated for hypothyroidism, can end up with advanced cardiovascular complications, secondary due to ischemic heart disease, decreased cardiac output, vascular resistance will be increased, ischemic heart disease, etc. Brain wise, person will have severe mental retardation, memory loss, intellectual function will be reduced, slow speech, severe headache. On reproductive organ, fertility will be markedly affected, irregular menstrual period. Usually the female may have a metrosmenorrhagia. In a newborn, it can give rise to severe mental retardation. in an older person, bradycardia, hypothermia, high mortality rate, severe hypotension, and multi-organ failure can also take place. These are cardiovascular effects. Cardiovascular mortality will increase, hypertension can be worsening, left ventricular function can worsen out. Person, hypothyroidism is usually not associated with atrial fibrillation. Neurological complications, reproductive complications, and person can go into mixed edema, and that is a dangerous one. Mixed edema is usually precipitated by infections, trauma, exposure to cold, cardiovascular problems, drugs, etc. Drastic decrease in the metabolic rate can produce hypoventilation and respiratory acidosis, hypothermia, hypotension, hypoglycemia, hyponatremia, hypercapnia, and hypoxia, all with H and all hypo. Hypoventilation will result into carbon dioxide retention, so hypercapnia, hypoxia, and respiratory acidosis. Because of marked decrease in the basal metabolism, hypothermia, decreased cardiac output, hypotension, decreased glucose production, hypoglycemia, retention of water, hyponatremia, etc. And all that will have effect on the mental status, orientation, lethargy, confusion, secondary strokes, sepsis, carbon dioxide narcosis, and mortality rate is very, very high. Precipitating factor very commonly of a mixed edema coma is because of cardiovascular event, myocardial infarction, infection like UTI, pneumonia, GI hemorrhage, acute trauma, sedatives, narcotics, potent diuretics, or cerebrovascular event like trauma, strokes, hypoglycemia, hypothermia, or because of carbon dioxide narcosis, potent diuretics, sedatives, drug overdose, all that can precipitate mixed edema coma. These are typical phases of hypothyroidism. You can see very classical phase. This is with goiter. This is with goiter. This is macroglossia. This is typical cretinism. These are all mixed edematous phase. This is hyperthyroidism. You can see all this. Good number of times they can develop a bilateral ptosis also. Absent eyebrows. This is mixed edema with carotenemias. Macroglossia, this is xanthomas, tuberous xanthomas, xanthalasma because of excessive cholesterol level. This is mixed edematous tissue, so solid edema. This is xanthomata. These are all that deposition of cholesterol material. Now there is one condition we call as a critically ill condition where it may not be related to the thyroid gland. A severe infection, severe liver disease, malignancy, traumatic injury, major surgery, AKI, severe congestive cardiac failure. Now in this particular critically ill patient, there is a decreased D1 action. So T4 conversion to T3 is inhibited. So T4 level will be normal or sometime it may be high and T3 level will be low. Or there is an increased D3 activity where T4 can be converted directly into reverse T3, or whatever T3 is there will be converted into reverse T3. So you will have a high level of reverse T3 and T4 level will be high. This will be very commonly seen in a person with a critically ill patient and TSH remain normal. These are very, very important because all parameters are normal on recovery. Once you treat this, T3, T4 and TSH level will become normal and even reverse T3 level will also become normal. It is also called as a sick euthyroid syndrome where there is a decreased T3 production with fasting and important adaptive response and there is an increased reverse T3 production because of activation of D3 enzyme. That is, we call the type 3 deiodinase enzyme and there is a normal level of TSH. This can happen in a non-thyroidal illness, what we have mentioned here, all this plus it can be burns, cirrhosis, renal failure, prolonged fasting, glucocorticoids excess, and certain drugs and certain advanced cancer. And you can see this is depending upon severe illness, what will happen. If it is a mild variety, T3 level is low and reverse T3 level is high, while T4 and TSH level is normal. But in a moderate and severe variety, you will see that T3 level falls remarkably. T4 level initially is slightly elevated, but later on that also falls. Reverse T3 level will start rising and TSH level will start falling when it becomes severe. But in a recovery stage, you can see that it comes back to normal. Free T3 level will be relatively low. Free T4 level will be low. Reverse T3 level will be still high and TSH level will come back to normal. And once the person gets full recovery, T3, T4 level will become normal. This will become normal. And this reverse T3 level will also become normal. So that will be full recovery. By and large, in investigations, we go for a thyroid hormone level, that is free T3, T4 level, TSH level. You can go for a thyroid scan if you want to identify how much of thyroid gland is preserved, particularly in a person with an iatrogenic variety, in a autoimmune thyroiditis variety, etc. You can go for a thyroid scan. In an acquired variety, you go for a T3 levels, TSH level antibody to rule out what we call as Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Ultrasound almost serves the purpose in place of a thyroid scan, because ultrasound can give you an idea regarding the size of thyroid gland. It is reduced or absent. But if you want to find out the uptake, because in a hypothyroidism, the uptake is reduced. So thyroid gland radioactive iodine uptake will be markedly reduced in case of a hypothyroidism. So by TSH level, you can find out it will be high in case of a primary hypothyroidism, and it will be markedly low in case of secondary and tertiary variety. TRH stimulation test will help you to differentiate between secondary and tertiary. We have already discussed in the thyroid function test. Some of the other tests, you can go for a calcitonin level, because when you have done a total thyroidectomy, you have removed simultaneously entire thyroid gland, so calcitonin level will be low, thyroglobulin level will be low, and in an autoimmune disorder, you can go for a TPO antibody, TRA antibody, and thyroglobulin antibodies. So they will be more. This will be very high in case of Hashimoto's, while TRA receptor stimulating antibody will be high in case of a Graves' disease, and globulin antibody will be also elevated in a Graves' disease. This is a standard chart we always mention in a person who is undergoing investigation for a thyroid disorders. These are all those charts I'm skipping over. We have already done in detail in a person in a chapter of thyroid function test. Always examine for the thyroid gland whether there is a goiter or no goiter, and then you look at the reports. These are all those things what we have discussed before. ECG does not give you much idea, but bradycardia and what we call is a low voltage QRS complex. This is a typical algorithm which you follow in a hypothyroidism. That is, I'll put the entire one so it will become very easy. So look at the TSH level. If it is elevated, go for a primary. If it is normal or it is low, consider central variety. Now if it is elevated and there is T4 level low, classical primary. And in primary you want to differentiate Hashimoto's from other, do TPO. TPO is high, Hashimoto's. TPO negative, other than Hashimoto's. And if T4 level is normal and TSH level is elevated, subclinical. Again in subclinical, look for TPO. So it will be in favor of early stage of Hashimoto's, where depending upon the clinical conditions, symptoms, etc., you can go for a T4 replacement. And if the TPO is negative, T3, T4 is normal, there is a slight elevation of TSH, You can go for a annual follow-up. You can go for a regular follow-up. If TSH is normal or low, look for TRH and what we call is a TRH level and other pituitary hormones level. If other pituitary hormones levels are also low, it goes in favor of pituitary induced. But if there is decreased level of T3, increased level of T4, and increased level of reverse T3, then it goes in favor of a sick euthyroid or critical illness disorders. And in those particular group, if the person has got low T4 and normal TSH, I'm using a word, low T4, or what we call as normal TSH, then also look for drug effects. So this is that algorithm what we have just mentioned. And whenever you get a TSH level normal and person has got features of hypothyroidism, look for pituitary, in which you will go for an MRI scan. And if there is no finding in MRI, you don't require a further test. If there is a finding in an MRI, you can go and measure free T4 level. If it is low, look for pituitary, sick euthyroid or drug effects. And if it is normal, don't go for investigations. In a subclinical variety, you will have a normal T3, T4 and TSH will be increased. In a primary, you will have a low T3, T4 level and TSH will be elevated. And then in both the cases, subclinical variety, go for a TPO antibody. TPO antibody will be positive in Hashimoto's, and it will be also positive in a case of a Hashimoto's in an early stage. This I'm skipping over. This is another good slide. You can go. This is for congenital hypothyroidism. These are some of the findings which you can see and where you can order only TSH level, psychiatric patient, elderly woman, patient with OSA, that is obstructive sleep apnea, hyperlipidemia, person on amiodarone, lithium, postpartum woman, autoimmune disease, Graves ophthalmopathy, family history of thyroid disorders, neck irradiation, previous history of thyrotoxicosis, autoimmune thyroiditis, etc. This is what you can see in a person, in a normal person with a normal pituitary fossa, normal clinoid process, no separation of sutures, etc. When there is a pituitary tumor, you can see that clinoid process is destroyed. There is a widening of pituitary fossa and you will start getting separation of sutures and you will have a secondary signs of a raised intracranial pressure, we call as a silver beaten appearance. This is a pericardial, massive pericardial effusion, secondary due to hypothyroidism. This is on treatment, now pericardial effusion is reducing. This is reappearance because the treatment was discontinued. Now, what are the treatment which is required? If a person is classical iodine deficiency, particularly say in Himachal Pradesh area, that is Himalayan territory, etc., iodine replacement. In all patients, you require hormone replacement therapy. That is replacement of T4, mainly levothyroxine is the best which is to be replaced. You can use T4, T3 mixture, or you can use a thyroid hormone from natural sources. These are all being utilized, but the best is levothyroxine. You can, in a diet, increase fiber, increase protein, increase fluid, increase calorie, avoid food containing excess of iodine. These are some of the materials which are आयोडाइज सॉल्ट्स, शेलफिश, कैबेज, पियर्स एटसेट्रा। As far as pharmacological treatment is concerned, you will have to give in hypothyroidism, person with simple goiter or endemic goiter, and person also with what we call as if a person has got comorbid condition, you will give replacement of levothyroxine. Indication is in an asymptomatic patient, that is subclinical variety with TSH more than 10. If it is asymptomatic and TPO antibody is strongly positive, and even if TSH is more than 5, symptomatic with TSH more than 5, pregnant woman with TSH more than 5, goiter with TSH more than 5, it is also indicated in all hypothyroidism, pituitary induced hypothyroidism with euthyroid goiter, thyroid nodule, Hashimoto's thyroiditis, or any person who has undergone surgery, radiotherapy for thyroid cancer also, and if they are hypothyroid, you must replace T34. Monitoring, regular monitoring should be done at the 6 to 8 weeks interval till TSH level reaches between 0.5 to 5.5. It depends on the what range the laboratory is utilizing. Ideally, we should maintain TSH close to 2.5, as close as possible. And after normalization, maintenance dose should be continued for lifetime. And you can increase or decrease depending upon the TSH level. Test should be repeated at a regular interval. Some person says that annually, or if person becomes symptomatic. Ideally, it should be done at 3 to 4 months interval or at 6 months interval. There is always a term called as a start slow, go slow. Usually start with 25, 50 or 100 microgram tablets which are available now. There are a lot of different strengths which are available. 25, 37, 38, 50, 62.5, then 75, 87, 100, 125, 112.5, 137, 150, it is available, all those strengths are available. Starting dose, if a person is healthy and less than 50 years, 1 microgram per kilogram body weight, you can go up to 1.6 microgram per kilogram body weight. A person who is more than 50 years age, usually you should start a dose less than 50 microgram per day and then gradually increase at 6 to 8 weeks interval after doing a TSH levels. A person with a heart disease starts with a very small dose, 12.5 or 25, and gradually increase the dose 12.5 to 25 at 6 to 8 weeks interval after doing a TSH level. Maximum dose you can go up to 1.6 microgram per kilogram per body weight, and in a person with cardiac disorders, starts with a small dose. Keep that thing in mind. Doses adjustment should be done according to the response, and also you will require doses adjustment in a person with malabsorption syndrome, concomitant drug therapy. During pregnancy, you will require to increase the dose. And in presence of cardiac disease, you will have to use with caution. In a non-pregnant, you can go from 1.7 to 2 microgram depending upon the preconception period and control it. Sometime, even you can go up to 2 to 2.4 microgram per kilogram body weight. But this is, you have to closely observe the person. There was one way of giving a treatment, weekly dosing, that all the dose multiplied by 7 was given on a single day, and then it was repeated every week. But there was good number of side effects, like high body temperature, tachycardia, atrial fibrillation, wide pulse pressure, agitation, flushing, sweating, diarrhea, etc. And because of this increased side effects, sometimes person can develop thyroid crisis. So weekly dosing was avoided. There is good number of drug interaction with this particular group. We commonly use ferrous sulfate, antacids, B-complex, etc., which will reduce the absorption. While a person who is taking rifampicin, carbamazepine, phenytoin, amiodarone will affect the metabolism. And by increasing the metabolism, the drug level will be reduced. So you have to keep it in mind. There is two things which can happen during your treatment, that is over-replacement. You can overdosing. It will produce osteoporosis, tachycardia, arrhythmias, particularly atrial flutter fibrillation. And person can have anginal attacks, ischemic heart disease, or sometime it can even precipitate myocardial infarction. Under replacement, because of the low dosing or person do not take on every day, that is called under replacement. So person will continue with a hypothyroid stage and can go into long-term and organ effects hypothyroidism, and person can have an increased risk of hyperlipidemia. So you must take care and see that the person is taking medicine regularly. All precautions are taken and a full dose is being given. Not over, not under. The symptom signs of improvement is immediately after 2 to 3 weeks, reduction in weight, facial puffiness will reduce, skin changes will improve, hair changes will also improve, but it will take a longer time. TSH will start showing decrease in the level and will come closer to normal. Once it comes between 0.5 to 4.5, maintain it close to 2.5 as normal as possible. But skin changes and hair changes will take a very, very long time to improve. Monitoring is very important. Always look for high dosing, low dosing. So try to adjust the dose and bring it down to normal. Diet in iodine therapy, particularly a person with iodine deficiency, iodized salts, selenium supplements, avoid cassava, avoid cabbage, avoid milk, certain milk preparations, avoid goitrogens, and increase intake of fish, certain meats, eggs, certain types of milk, etc. Levothyroxine has to be for a lifelong therapy. It is almost, in case of myxedema coma, you might have to give a levothyroxine in injectable form. You will have to give a supportive treatment in the form of the oxygen administration, IV fluids, mental vital signs, correct hypothermia, vasopressors. Levothyroxine has to be given in the form of IV. You will have to give IV glucose, IV glucocorticoids. So external warming, glucocorticoids, or we call hydrocortisone. Sometimes you require a broad spectrum antibiotic, also ventilatory supports. IV glucose with saline, etc. may be needed. Levothyroxine has to be given in a single IV bolus, 500, actually it should be 500 milligram, sorry. And it serves the dose, loading dose of 50 to 100 microgram per deciliter, a loading dose of this. This should be a microgram. Oxygen, cardiac output monitoring, hydrocortisone, glucose infusion, etc. has to be given. And this is an emergency, so it should be transferred to an ICU where all these things are given. You give a T3 IV, 100 microgram, 6 hourly. You can go up to 500 microgram of T4 also. Antibiotics, ventilation, hydrocortisone, passive warming, volume replacement, gradual volume replacement, etc. All those things should be given and monitored. In a subclinical variety, we have already mentioned you have to go for all this level estimation. And a person with certain features, we have already mentioned before, that even if the TSH is more than, just more than 5, but if the person has got TPO positive, pregnancy, preconception period, person with hyperlipidemia, person with ischemic heart disease, person with hypertension, person developing symptoms, symptomatic, with subclinical hypothyroid reports should be treated. This is congenital hypothyroidism. I'm skipping over. You can go at your leisure times. Complications in myxedema is myxedema coma, respiratory failure, hypotension, hyponatremia, hypothermia, hypoglycemia. These are the common features in myxedema. In cretinisms and in a case of a, we call as a congenital hypothyroidism, you will have a severe mental retardation, pericardial effusion, pleural effusion, ascites, sterility, bradycardia. There are a lot number of other complications also. Also in a adult variety myxedema, you can have slowly mental retardation in a severe myxedema. These are recent advances which are going on. There are some of the other type of a defects which are being identified because of the mutation of different genes, thyroid receptor alpha mutations, deiodinase deficiency. There is a mutation of a transporter gene, 8 gene, etc. These are all the different advances which are being there. I end my lecture on hypothyroidism here. This is the most common disease you will see in your everyday practice. And the most common endocrine disorders among all endocrine disorders. So, see you in the next lecture. Hope this will be very helpful to you.